in place of our typical get up and shake hands greeting time, would you just maybe look around, stay in your seat, give people a wave, let everybody know you're glad we're here, right? Good to see you. Good to see all of you. Just a couple announcements I wanted to run through really quickly. Many, many thanks for those that have volunteered to help with the Meals on Wheels for November. Our church is taking care of that. I believe the schedule is full, right? So we've got enough volunteers. That is excellent. Also wanted to mention to you, we will be, are any of you dreaming of a white Christmas? Oh. What if I said white as in hope? And what if I said white inside the building? So that might help. We'll be decorating with beautiful white poinsettias for the Christmas, Advent and Christmas season this year. If you are interested in purchasing one of those plants in memory of someone or in honor of someone, as we have done in the past, those order forms have been emailed out, as well as they are available out at the Welcome Center, where you can contact the office in purchasing those. We'd like orders in by November 15th, because believe it or not, folks, the first Sunday in Advent is already the last Sunday in November. So we'll be looking at decorating and getting things looking very Christmassy around here very soon. So. Just to have on your radar, and I believe Emily Schaefer will be sharing more about this later, but we've got Church World Service Blanket Sunday coming up on November 15th. Many of you are familiar with that program. If you're not, I encourage you to research that, talk to Emily, talk to myself, but be aware we'll be taking a special offering to purchase those blankets on November 15th. Today, we are going to participate in Holy Communion. It's going to look a little bit different than what we're used to in the past with our COVID guidelines. We'll be doing what's called an exit communion. So there will be appropriate words as far as a communion service. We'll dismiss you from the sanctuary, and as you leave the sanctuary, the communion stewards will be outside the doors there to distribute the elements to you. They're pretty nifty. They're an all-in-one communion cup, which I know you probably can't all see me from here, but there's a top film that you peel back, and you find your communion wafer on the top, and then there's a foil seal that releases the juice underneath. There again, the communion stewards will distribute these to you as you exit the building. You take these with you and can partake at your convenience after you leave the building. So we're doing our best during this COVID time to honor our traditions and to administer the sacraments, but it looks a little bit different. So also at noon, we'll be doing a drive-through option for those who are not comfortable coming to the sanctuary for worship yet. They will enter through the back alleyway here from the north. We'll distribute those elements here right outside the church building and exit to the south. So if you leave our worship service and know of those who maybe would appreciate being served communion in that fashion, please share that with them. We'll be starting at noon. I think that's all I've got for right now. I'll ask you to center your hearts as Joanne leads us in the prelude this morning.
Thank you.
like to share a scripture this morning from the book of Philippians, the first chapter, verses 12 through 26. I'll be focusing on kind of the latter portion of that excerpt, but I want to start with verse 12 to give us a little background or a little context. Again, this is Paul's letter to the Philippians. He says, "I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Yes, and I will rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance, as it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not at all be ashamed, but that with full courage now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which shall I choose, I cannot tell. I'm hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again." That's God's word for us this morning. For the next few weeks, we're going to focus on Paul's letter to the Philippians. Throughout the series, I'd really like you to be considering reasons to be thankful. Maybe we could call this next few weeks in series looking for reasons to be thankful. Philippians is all about gratitude and joy, and it's a great time to study it because I want to prepare us for Thanksgiving. I also want to prepare us for that fast approaching Advent and Christmas season. More than anything, though, I want all of us to be happy in the Lord, as Paul is himself in this letter. I'm sure some of you, even walking in this morning, had things on your mind as far as the election season, or COVID, or any number of things that may be kind of putting a damper on your mood. And you're going to say, you know, I've got these other things going on. I'm not feeling very joyful right now. Or maybe you're going to say, you know what? It's great that Paul is feeling joyful in this letter. I'm not Paul. And that's when I'm going to say, you know what? You're right. You're not. You're not Paul. His life was much more difficult than anything that we are going to know, filled with much more suffering and much more pain and much more loss than anything we're going to experience in our lives. So no, you're not Paul. And yet his life, with all of the trials and tribulations he encountered, he's in prison. It's clear in this letter that his life is characterized by great joy. And that's what I want in my life. Would you like that in your life? If I said, I can give you great joy in your life by teaching you about Christ, would you sign up? Yes? Thank you. Thank you. Most scholars believe that Paul is writing this letter from prison in Rome. We're told that, toward the book of Acts, that Paul has been arrested for preaching a religion that wasn't approved on the list of religions in the Roman Empire. Judaism, the Romans thought, you know, that's bad enough, but they tolerated it, and now they've got this weird kind of sect of Judaism, Christianity, and that's something else entirely. They're not really sure what to do with that. So the Romans arrest Paul. And Paul is a Roman citizen. So he appeals to Caesar. He's got that right to appeal to Caesar, and legally, therefore, he's entitled to an audience before the emperor himself in Rome. So the Romans ship Paul off to Rome. We're told that Paul would spend 2 years under house arrest in Rome. Now, in our current society, when we hear that someone's under house arrest, what does that really look like? And I see a few teenagers maybe that would say house arrest is really the worst thing that could ever happen. But for most of us, when we hear of someone being sentenced to house arrest, we think, well, they've got an ankle monitor on, and they've got to stay within proximity of their home, but they can probably, you know, binge watch Netflix and order pizza and live their life as they choose. Well, that's not how it would have been for Paul. 24/7, Paul very literally has a Roman soldier chained to him. He is chained to another man, a Roman guard. These guards would have worked in shifts, so they're switching out, but Paul always has a Roman guard literally chained to him. So think about that for a moment. For 2 years, Paul has no semblance of privacy. He's not even able to go to the bathroom without someone else being with him, chained to him. On the other hand, I want you to consider what it would be like if you're a Roman soldier chained to the most persuasive evangelist that the world has ever known. You guessed it, Paul is able to convert these soldiers to Christianity, and Scripture tells us he lived there 2 whole years at his own expense, welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. So Paul wrote this letter during this 2-year period, not long before he was beheaded by the Emperor Nero, and it's during a great time of persecution of Christians. And so, as we're reading it, and we're talking about him being joyful, and he's in prison writing to the Philippians, you can't help but wonder, well, why did he write it? Why is he writing in the first place? Well, the Philippians love Paul. They supported his ministry financially. They're worried about him. They would want to hear from him. And after all, he's facing trial, possible execution in Rome. And also, we have to understand that what happens with Paul's ministry when he's in prison. How is he handling what by all appearances is a major setback in his life and his career? Is he depressed? Is he disappointed, discouraged? Would you blame him if he were? So Paul writes in verse 12, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. And he starts out by saying, I want you to know, because what he's about to say isn't something that would have been obvious to them. It would have been surprising. They're expecting Paul perhaps to complain about his circumstances. He's been imprisoned. He's got a Roman guard chained to him. He's got no life, right? Is how we would kind of look at it in society. They would want him to complain and tell him how terrible it is and let him know just what exactly is happening there. It seems it's derailed his life's mission. How is he going to minister to people? But instead, Paul says that what's happened to him has actually helped fulfill his life's mission. He says the gospel's being preached throughout the whole Imperial Guard. And the Imperial Guard was highly trained elite soldiers who are working for Caesar himself. They were Caesar's men. And Paul is preaching the gospel to them, and they're being converted, and then they're going and preaching the gospel and converting others, and the gospel is extending. When we read on, we'll find that the gospel even reaches Caesar's household, and all of that is a result of Paul's imprisonment. And in verse 14, it says, most of the brothers, that is the Christians who live in Rome, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, they're much more bold to speak the word without fear. That means they've seen Paul's example and his courage and his fearlessness at sharing the gospel no matter what it costs. And they've seen how he's laid his life on the line for Jesus, and now they're inspired to do the same. So of course, that's another really good result of Paul being in prison. In verses 15 to 18, Paul says, some of the people in the church are preaching Christ from envy and rivalry, out of selfish ambition. Now, we don't really know who he's referring to there. The Philippians probably would have known who Paul was talking about. Likely people who believe Paul was preaching an inferior version of the gospel and that he was being judged by being put in prison. Or maybe they're just jealous of Paul because of the way other Christians admire him. They want to be admired in the same way. They want people to think of them as highly as they think of Paul. Whatever the reason, these opponents of Paul are still out there, and they're still preaching Christ. Regardless of their motives, the message is still getting out, and that's what Paul is focusing on. He's saying that's what matters right now. The gospel itself has a power that doesn't depend on the people who are proclaiming it. The Holy Spirit works through it to bring people to saving faith. So Paul says even these people, as impure as their motives may be, they're advancing the gospel, not because of who they are, but because of who God is. So he's got all these things going on here, but he's finding all these reasons to be thankful for the circumstances, and he's looking for the good in all things. As we apply this scripture to our lives, what reasons do we have to be thankful? Most of the time in our lives, we like to think that we're in control, that we're running the show, that we're steering the ship, that we are guiding our own destiny, but yet we find ourselves in situations over and over again where we have so little control, just like Paul. Have you noticed that? Have you noticed how sometimes you get up in the morning and make plans for what you want to do in the day and none of that happens because something else gets in the way or takes over? Have you noticed how little control you truly have? You can't control your boss, can you? You can't control your spouse. I've tried. You can't control your children. You can teach them, you can correct them, you can encourage them. You can't truly control what they're going to do, especially as they get older. They become their own people pretty quickly. We can't control our families. We can't make people act a certain way. We can't control our friends. We can't control the people we work with. We can't control church members. Again, I've tried. That doesn't work. Even in our best efforts, we can't truly control what happens in our own bodies. We can certainly make good choices. We can take precautions. But we can't control how our bodies age or what disease we may have inherited. We can't control the economy. We can't control the weather. We can't control other drivers. We can't control the behavior of a criminal or a terrorist. Given that we have so little control in the world, what do we do? When I say you can't control the weather, you're like, well, I know that. Well, what do? Complain about it? No. Can't control what other people do. What do about it? Complain about it? Do we just accept fate? Or do we feel resentment that circumstances beyond our control have conspired to put us here in our present circumstance? Have you ever noticed, I was watching a primetime TV show recently, and characters rarely talk about God doing anything in their lives, but they will describe the universe in God-like terms. I guess they figure they won't offend anyone with that language. Except for an example, there were two characters that fell in love, and one of them said something like, the universe is giving us a sign. We're meant to be together. And I thought, the universe? What kind of superstitious nonsense is that? We don't believe in the universe doing anything, but But we do believe the creator of the universe is working all things for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. When we find ourselves in circumstances beyond our control, it's a perfect time to rejoice that God is in control. When we find that our lives aren't going just quite according to our plans, maybe instead of complaining about it, we can rejoice that our lives are going exactly according to God's plan. Paul could have been any number of things. He could have been, we'll just say, disappointed, discouraged. He could have been disappointed that his plans weren't working out. This isn't the ministry that he had in mind. He didn't think he would be imprisoned. He didn't think he would be in chains. But disappointment becomes his appointment. Paul saw another plan at work, a better plan. God had appointed him to be in chains, to advance the gospel to so many people that needed to hear it. Friends, what if we were to follow Paul's example? And when you're disappointed, instead of getting angry, instead of getting bitter, instead of getting resentful, stop and tell yourself, you know what, God must have something else in store for me, something better for me as a result of this change of plans. I have a fellow pastor, a clergy colleague, that told me once, he says, I think people get depressed when we listen to ourselves instead of talking to ourselves. And when I asked what he meant by that, he said, you know, if you listen to yourself too much, it's easy to hear, oh, woe is me. This didn't turn out the way that I wanted. I can't believe this is happening to me. I can't believe what these other people have done to me. It's the end of the world. I want to curl up in a ball and die. And he said, stop listening to yourself and start talking to yourself. Remind yourself what God's word says. Ultimately, you're not in control of what's happening to you. And other people aren't ultimately in control of what's happening to you. God is in control. He's got a purpose. He's got a plan. Tell yourself that. And don't just tell yourself that. Believe that. And if you feel like blaming God for the circumstances you find yourself in, you know what? God can take it. Let him know how you feel. I promise you, in hindsight, you'll probably begin to see how God has used your setback or used your disappointment for your good, for the good of others, for the good of his kingdom. And now you're thinking, okay, Pastor Jennifer is talking about God transforming our disappointments into something good. That's great. That's cool. That's a feel-good message. We like that. But if you were paying attention, you know that Paul's imprisonment in Rome would ultimately lead to his death. And despite the hope expressed that Paul would come and visit the Philippians again, he never had a chance. He never got out of prison. He was executed. So now you're going to say, well, how did that work out for Paul? And then I get to say, worked out beautifully. Worked out better than Paul could have imagined. It by far surpassed any of his own plans because he went to heaven. Because for him, living is Christ, dying is gain. Because he got to depart and be with Christ, which, as he says, is far better than being here. But now stay with me. We're not there yet. He says, as long as he is here, to live is Christ. He says, every moment of life in this world is an opportunity to know Christ, to glorify Christ, to grow closer to Christ, to live for Christ. So now the question we have to ask ourselves, when we're saying, oh, this didn't go the way I planned, or the weather isn't what I wanted. Can you be thankful? Is Christ enough? It's more than you need. Can we be thankful? Is Christ enough? Because you can always have Christ. You can't always necessarily have the man or woman of your dreams. I do. I lucked out. But you don't always have things turn out the way you wanted. You don't necessarily have fame or popularity, if that's what you're going for. You can't necessarily have the dream body that you thought you would have. You can't necessarily go to the college of your dreams. Maybe you can't necessarily have a lot of money. You can't necessarily have your dream job or your dream house or your dream car or your dream retirement. But you can have Christ. Is that enough for you? You know, people often joke, I'm one of them. People say, how are you doing? You say, living the dream. Well, you know, at least in a worldly sense, no one can do that. The way we think of living the dream, whether that's fame and fortune or however you term that success, living the dream, no one can really do that in a worldly sense. You know, rehab facilities are full of those we consider to be rich and famous or celebrities that seem to have it all. Yet every single one of us in this room, every single one of you watching at home, everyone, we have this opportunity to live the dream. So long as we define that dream as knowing and loving and enjoying and glorifying and serving our Lord Jesus Christ. Living with him forever. Getting heaven as part of the deal. Is that enough of a dream for you? Do we have something to be thankful for? Friends, if that's our dream will come true. Paul says to live is Christ. May we be thankful. May we be thankful to live in Christ. Every single moment, every single day. That is my prayer for all of us. Amen.
The song I'd like to sing for you today is a modern-day interpretation of the scripture that Pastor Jennifer read to us and explained to us during her message today. I just want to reread a little bit of it just to put it back into your mind, what we're talking about, from Philippians 1, verse 20 and 21. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage, so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain.
If I rise, let me rise on you, not on all of my successes, my esteem or my pursuits. If I lose, let me lose my life. 'Cause if I belong to Jesus, the flesh is crucified. For me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain.
I think I need to share with you that as I was preparing this series and this message and looking at the scriptures and that song done by a group called Sidewalk Prophets, I'd seen even the video online, and I brought it to Sue and I said, do you think we could do this for, you know, to live as Christ? And she said yes, before she even looked at the music. And I appreciate so much, she makes it look pretty easy. So. Thank you, Sue, for adding to our worship. I appreciate it. As we come to a time of prayer, one prayer concern that I will share, Marilyn's brother Bob passed away yesterday. So Marilyn, we keep you in our prayers and your family. I haven't been given any other names to share with you today, but I know we've got names written on our hearts. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we come to you the first day of November. We've changed clocks. We're looking at an election this week. We're looking at changes in season. We've got so many things going on. And could you remind us, Lord, to take a moment to be still, to know that you are God, to express our thanks. because, Lord, it is with thanksgiving that we come to you first and foremost for the many, many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for showing us in your word today how important it is to maybe step back from our circumstances once in a while, to recognize that you're working, that you can bring good from all things, and that we are part of the plan. Use us. Fill us with your spirit and use us for the good of others and for the good of your kingdom. We thank you for being a constant in our lives, for rejoicing with us through all things, for providing us with that great joy that only comes from you. And Lord, for those who are in times of trial, for those who are suffering or hurting, we pray for your healing. We pray for the mending of fences. We pray that your presence can be felt and known to all of us, especially to those who maybe don't even know that they're seeking you. For those who are experiencing, whether it be physical illness, mental illness, spiritual distress, emotional problems, problems at work, problems at school, problems in relationships, problems with money, problems with addictions, problems just in any area. Lord, we pray for your guidance, for your encouragement. Again, if you could bind us together as your body so we can help one another, that is our prayer. Continue to lead us on the path that you have chosen for us. Continue to show us that you are the way. Remind us, Lord, that to live is Christ. We thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. As we come to a time of Holy Communion, I've invited some folks to help with that service today. I'll also point out to you that during our communion service, we will recognize that it is All Saints Day by naming those that have gone on from this congregation. I'm going to begin by reading to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Thanks be to God. Holy wisdom is with us.
We praise you, Christ crucified.
Holy Spirit breathes in us.
Spirit of power, Spirit of life.
Holy source of all draws near.
In you alone we boast, with all creation we sing.
Holy are you, O God, ever creating, stirring in the souls and bringing among us those we least expect.
Holy are you, O God.
Holy are you, O God, enfleshed in Jesus, delivering us from the power of sin and death, empowering the Spirit, and interrupting our talk and explanations with unmistakable signs of your saving power.
Holy are you, O God.
Holy the food Jesus gave when on the night of his betrayal he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples. Holy the words he spoke then, and your Spirit speaks still.
This is my body broken for you. Remember me.
Holy the drink Jesus offered when that same night he took the cup, thanked you, and shared it. Holy the words he spoke then, and your Spirit speaks still.
This is my blood of the new covenant for you. Remember me.
We remember you, source, wisdom, and Spirit of holiness. We praise you not only with our lips, but with our lives.
Jesus Christ crucified, you called and claimed us. Risen, you have raised us. Coming again, you make all things new. Come, Lord Jesus, hallelujah.
Thank you.
Come and fill this feast, Holy Spirit, Spirit of power, Spirit of life.
Come upon us and these gifts of bread and wine.
Make them be for us what Jesus says they are, Christ's body, Christ's blood.
Make us become what Jesus prays we are, one body in him, empowered and enlivened by his blood.
One in service, one in witness, one in compassion, and one even now in prayer, saying,
Lord, have mercy.
One in communion with the saints. We rejoice with those from this congregation who have come to dwell in your presence, going on before us in the past year. Today we speak their names in thanksgiving and communion.
Chris Williams.
Betty Willison.
Burl Johnson.
Shirley Holly.
Shirley Squirman.
Pat Johnson.
Silva Wallace.
And for all the saints who from their labors rest,
Lord, have mercy.
We are one with all persons kept in poverty or slavery, with all who are in fear from abusers and oppressors, with all who face addiction of any kind, and with all who are targeted for unjust treatment because of who they are.
Lord, have mercy.
One with all the earth and all the creatures upon it.
Lord, have mercy.
One in prayer for leaders in religious, political, economic, and social life, and for all who work to sustain and protect our lives.
Lord, have mercy.
One with families, friends, and neighbors, near and far, like us and different from us, with all who need your healing power.
Lord, have mercy.
So may this food and drink be holy, and nourish us in holy conversation this day and every day, as on that day we feast with him in new creation. And now and forever, all glory to you, Holy Spirit, holy wisdom, holy source of all that was and is to come. Amen. I'll ask the communion stewards to come forward. As our typical practice has been, friends, I'll ask you to dismiss from the back pews first. And your communion elements will be distributed as you exit the building. Have a very blessed week.